We are live.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Elena. I am a member of And Sewing is Half the Battle. We are a cosplay team based in Central Indiana. We have been cosplaying for a lot of years. Our cosplay careers could vote in this election if they wanted to. And I'm going to be talking today about found object costuming, which is taking things that already exist and turning them into cosplay accessories or costumes. And this is going to run for about 2 hours, but we're going to have time for Q&A. You're welcome to drop questions directly into the chat on YouTube or Facebook, make comments, and my little helper will forward them into me and I can answer your questions. So let's get started. Okay, so the art of found object costuming is the title of our discussion today. There we go. So when we talk about found objects are things that already exist in a finished form. It's something that has been manufactured or that you find that already serves a function. It can be commercially produced, or it can just be something you had lying around the house or in your garage, and it doesn't have to be used in its original form or for its original purpose. Case in point, the photo you're seeing here, this is my Stuttgart Loki costume from the Avengers. The glow stick of destiny, that glowing staff, is made out of a broken broom handle, a Coke bottle, a sheet protector from a three-ring binder, an LED Halloween glow stick, and some scrap foam. All of those things are found objects. None of them are being used for their original purpose. In fact, this was made out of literal trash that I was pulling out of my kitchen trash can and put together in about 15 minutes. It's not a high-tech prop, but all I cared was that I had something to carry around as the character, and it worked for that. So you have a lot of leeway in how you use these objects. Why would you use these objects? Well, first of all, it's usually cheaper than buying something new. And I'm a big fan of cheap. I do spend money on costumes sometimes, but the cheaper I can do it, the better, because then I have more money to spend on other fun things. So you can sometimes go to a thrift store and find something very inexpensive. You can look through your closet. You can look through the shed in the backyard. You can go to a garage sale and you can find things to repurpose. This Sid costume from Advanced Dimensional Green Ninja Educational Preparatory Super Elementary Fortress 555, which is a role-playing game, if you were wondering, that is the actual name. The character has a futuristic hoverboard. So I went to Goodwill. I found a broken down old snowboard, brought it home, painted it, taped some CDs on the bottom, and now I have a futuristic hoverboard. Very cheap, very fun to do, and very easy. Frequently, if you're making a fabric costume and you're using found objects, it can save you the effort of sewing something. If your character wears a t-shirt, why should you have to make a t-shirt from scratch if you can just pull a t-shirt out of your closet? For this Mario costume that my friend Ken made, it's a long sleeve shirt and some gloves and some overalls. All of those things are commercially available. He didn't have to sew anything for it. A lot of the costumes that we want to cosplay, if it's from a video game or a comic book or a movie, they're things that exist in real life because those actors are wearing real clothes and you can find those things in real life very easily. So don't make it harder than it needs to be. If you can use something that already exists, do it. And another thing that if you're going for a specific look for a character who maybe is a military character or an adventurer or an explorer or somebody who wouldn't be dressed in very pristine clothing, having clothes that are already broken in or props that are already a little bit worn down can make your costume look extremely realistic. So Nathan Drake from Uncharted, which is what this photo is, This costume is made out of clothes that were already damaged. There are shreds coming out of the jeans. There's dirt on everything. I distressed the shirt by putting additional dirt and paint and things on it, and I'm going to talk about that a little later. But everything here was stuff that I already had broken down, worn out clothing, and it made it look more realistic than going out and buying something new. It's also environmentally responsible, especially if you're using things that are made out of plastic or materials that don't break down. Rather than buying a new piece of plastic that's never going to biodegrade, use a piece of plastic that's already in existence and is never going to biodegrade. And one thing I really like to do is treat it like a creative challenge. So if you say, I think I want to do a costume for this event, or I want to dress up for Halloween, I'm going to see if I can do it without spending any money at all. What can I find around the house to turn into a costume? Especially during a pandemic year when we're all stuck at home with nothing to do but clean out our closets, this is a really fun way to use those things you find in the back of your closet that you forgot you owned. Now, the term closet cosplay gets thrown around a lot, and it's frequently treated as a pejorative term, something that's not really respected. That's not specifically what we're talking about here. All closet cosplays are, by definition, found object cosplays, because if you're pulling things out of your closet, you had to find those objects. They're not things that are being made from scratch. However, in terms of a negative thing, found object cosplays can be very elaborate. They can be very detailed. They can be very, very good costumes. So I don't want anyone to think, oh, just because I didn't make it from scratch, it's not a real costume. It's not a good costume. Because a lot of times you can come up with costumes that are extremely realistic, very detailed, very, very authentic to the character. And it's not a bad thing to use found objects for those. So these are some closet cosplays that I've done. Things where I literally went to my closet, pulled out a jacket, pulled out a t-shirt, and said, I'm going to throw this together and go to this movie premiere or go to this event. Or sometimes I didn't even leave the house. I'm just like, hey, I bet I can dress up as that character and take a photo. So all of these are very quick, easy closet cosplays. All of these are found object costumes that are not things that look like you just grabbed whatever was lying on in your laundry pile and put it on. A lot of these required a lot of modification, tailoring, changing things, painting, sewing, applique, doing things to make them look different than they originally looked. So some of these were actually competition costumes. They still started as found items, but they're much more elaborate. So don't feel like you have to make everything from scratch to be a quote unquote real costume. It still can be a very good costume and a very accurate costume, even if you're using found objects. Just in general, you get to decide what you want to put in to your costume. If you have a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of money that you want to put into your costume, good. You can decide if you want to do that. If you have no time and no money and no effort and you want to put something together out of your closet and just wear what you've got, that's okay. No, there are no cosplay police saying, oh, you didn't put enough time in, that's not a real costume. Wear what you want to wear, do what you want to do. You get to make those calls. Okay, we got that out of the way. All right, let's talk about costuming. When you are choosing what costume to wear, and this applies across the board, the first step is to identify what your resources are. Your resources are not just things like budget, although that is a factor. How much money do you want to put into this? Or what can you apply out of things you already have? Time is also a valuable resource. If your event is tomorrow, you're looking at a very different situation than if your event is in 6 months. If it's tomorrow, you're pretty much limited to what you can get right now out of areas you can access right now. You don't have time to wait for the store to open tomorrow morning. You need to have this tonight. If you have 6 months, then hey, you can look on eBay, you can go to a garage sale, you can go through your friends' closets in a year that doesn't rhyme with 2020, you have a lot more resources available to you. Available materials. What do you already have? Do you have a fabric stash? Do you have clothes that you were going to get rid of? Do you have a Goodwill up the street or a Salvation Army or any thrift store? Also, what kind of workspace and what kind of work equipment? If you want to make something that's very, very tailored, do you have access to a sewing machine or sewing supplies, or are you going to be limited to what can you already find that's exactly the size you need it to be? All of these are considerations. Here's your basic law of resources. And again, this doesn't just apply to found objects. This applies to all costumes across the board. You can pick any two out of the three of fast, cheap, and good. You can get something that's fast and good, but may not be cheap. You can get something that's fast and cheap, but may or may not be good, and cheap and good, but probably takes a little more time. It is possible to get all three of these, but only rarely. It's not the common thing. So decide what the most important consideration is to you. If your event is tomorrow, you're sacrificing one of the other two things to get what you need right now. If you have lots of time, but maybe you don't have a really big budget, then you want to focus on spending that time and going with cheap and good. It's up to you. It's your call. But just have that in mind when you're working on this. So think about what your skill level in various applications is. Do you know how to sew? Do you know how to draw or paint? Do you have friends or relatives that you can blackmail or press into service? Do you have things that you can bring to a costume to make it your own that are your particular talents? What are you good at? What can you use? And those skills may help you narrow down what costumes you want to do. If you have a costume that has a lot of surface detail on it, a lot of designs, and you may not know how to sew, but you're really, really good at fabric painting, that could be something you could apply there. If you are terrible at fabric painting, but you're really good at sewing, instead of painting on those designs, you could applique on those designs and sew them on. If you are not good at painting or sewing, but you're really good with a bottle of glue and you think you can fabric glue those on, that's another way to do it. So think about what skills you have that will help you in constructing your costume. Also think about how complex this costume is. Is it going to require a lot of fabric modification? Is it going to require props? You know, does this character have to have a sword to be recognizable? Does this character have specific costume elements like hats or sunglasses that you need to find? Does this character require a wig or special makeup? Is the character human? If not, you may need to do more makeup. What are things you can do to make yourself look more like that character, and how much work are they going to take? One thing that you can do to save yourself a little effort is choose a costume based on attributes you already have. This isn't something you have to do, but if you're in a hurry and you don't want to buy a wig or something, you can cheat a little bit by using elements that are specific to yourself. Things like if you look like a character, if you look like an actor. I remember a few years ago when the Hobbit films came out, not Lord of the Rings, but Hobbit, that had the character Toriel played by Evangeline Lilly. I had a lot of people contact me the day that the first poster featuring that character came out, because I look a lot like Evangeline Lilly. And with the hairstyle that she had, the wig that she had on, really did look like me. And everybody said, you have to cosplay this character because you look just like her. Well, that's not the only thing you can, you know, you don't have to cosplay every character that looks like you, but it made it really easy for me when I decided to throw together a Hobbit costume, because I didn't have to worry about the hair or makeup because I already looked like the character. If you are a very tall person or a very short person, you might pick a character who fits your height. If you have a specific hairstyle or just a general look, you can choose a character that have those attributes. You don't have to. Again, you can cosplay whoever or whatever you want, but those are things that can make it easier for you. Another example of this, obviously I have a lot of hair. And a couple years ago, several years ago now, we were asked to do a movie costume themed event for the Children's Museum and Museum of Indianapolis. And I needed to throw together a kid-friendly movie costume very quickly. And so I decided, oh, I can do Princess Leia because I don't need to buy a wig for that. I don't have to wait for a wig to ship to my house. I already have the hair. So I chose the simplest of Leia's costumes, put together the fabric part in a couple of days, and I already had the hair. So I didn't have to worry about that. That was something I was able to save time and money on because I already had those elements. On the other hand, if you want to do somebody who looks nothing like you and has maybe short hair or a big 60s wig or blue skin, these are other costumes that I've done that don't look like me. So you're not limited to cosplaying characters who are similar to yourself. Always remember, you are free to cosplay whoever and whatever you want. However, if you are doing a found object costume because you want to do it quickly and inexpensively, choosing a character who already has those attributes may save you some time and effort and money. In the case of wigs, wigs are not cheap. So when you are looking at the costume you want to do, think about the attributes that are most salient about that costume. And the first thing most people think of is color. So if I pop up these rectangles, your brain can pretty quickly identify, oh, Superman and Batman. Not because they look like Superman and Batman, but because we have been trained through constant exposure. Superman has these colors in his costume, and Batman has these colors in his costume. You can do the same thing with things like fast food color schemes. McDonald's is always going to be red and yellow. Taco Bell is always going to have purple. You know, there are always those little elements that it's part of branding. It's part of marketing. But our brains are hardwired to remember certain color patterns and certain attributes. And by making sure you get those details accurate first, you're already priming people who look at your costume to recognize who you're cosplaying. Another thing that can really help sell a character or sell a costume to your audience is having a distinctive costume piece or a distinctive prop if your character carries one. So, for example, Indiana Jones. If you are dressing up as Indiana Jones, the thing you must have, even if you get other parts of the costume wrong or don't have all the elements, you have to have the fedora, because Indiana Jones always has the fedora. If you're dressing up as Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz, you really ought to have some ruby slippers. You know, these are costume elements that are so closely tied to the character that the character is almost not recognizable without them. So if you're playing a very iconic character or a very recognizable character, like Batman, for example, you really want to think about what is the one thing that my costume must have for this character to be recognizable. And, you know, no one's really going to care about, oh gosh, your pants didn't have the exact right measurement on the cuff. Nobody's going to go around looking at those things, but they will remember whether or not you have the Indiana Jones fedora. One example of this is differentiating characters who have very similar wardrobes. So here's a bunch of different characters who are all fairly iconic characters who all just wear suits. You know, Robert Downey Jr. as Tony Stark, most of the time you see him in a suit. He doesn't even always have the arc reactor showing. He's just a guy in a suit who happens to have very distinctive facial hair and sunglasses. Those are the things you see if you have somebody dressed as Tony Stark. The 10th Doctor, played by David Tennant, he's in a pinstripe suit. He also will have a specific hairstyle and glasses. You know, there are things that you can really make recognizable in details. So even if your character is just wearing a suit, make sure you get the details right so that they know which variation of a guy in a suit you are. Another thing that can help convince people of what your character is just being in character. And that can be posing for photographs. That can be when you're walking around your convention or your get together or the movie theater at your movie premiere, whatever it is that you're going to. Being in character can really convey what your character is, even if it's a character who wears mostly street clothes. So I've done a lot of Nathan Drake costumes because I really like the Uncharted video game series. And when I do photo shoots, I'm often doing active on location shoots. I've got photos of me dangling off a suspension bridge that's collapsing. I've got photos of me climbing rock walls. I've got photos of me in a lot of different situations. And then you have the picture on the right where I'm literally standing in the staff room at a convention and somebody snapped a photo when I wasn't ready for it. So it's me standing in front of a salad bar. Not really convincing for that character. It's not a very good photo. So being in character and acting like the character and posing like the character will give you a better result than just standing around eating lunch. And ultimately, details matter. The more detail you incorporate into your costume, the more convincing and believable your character will be. And you know, you don't have to, every event you go to doesn't have to be like competition level. Oh my gosh, I have to get all the makeup right and all the hair right and all the details right. But the more you put in, especially to the fabric parts of your costume or the props of your costume, the more people are going to recognize you and get excited about a character they love to see being brought to life. So here's an example, simple comparison. So I did a Lara Croft costume from the original Tomb Raider. It's all thrift store clothing and simple accessories that I made myself. I didn't put a lot of effort in. I did this character mostly because, you know, I do like the games, but also because it was a character I could use my real hair with. And that's something that I don't have to wear a wig on Sunday of a convention. And it's a recognizable costume. Everybody knows who I'm dressed as. But my friend Brianna did the 2013 Tomb Raider reboot, and she did this costume with blood stains and mud splatters and, you know, her hair, things in her hair teased up, and, you know, it just looked really, really beaten up like the character does in the game. And while they were out shooting this costume on this photo shoot, she kept having people coming up to her and asking if she was okay and they needed to call someone for her because clearly she was in a terrible situation. And of course, she's there with her photographer and her friends and her bag of other things. You know, she wasn't in trouble at all. But it was so much more convincing because she put the extra detail in, because she did the distressing to the costume and she did the makeup and she did the hair. So there's nothing wrong with doing this type of character if you just want to dress up as the character. But if you want to be absolutely convincing, going the extra step and doing a little more detail can really help sell your costume. One problem that you run into with some found object costumes is they're based on street clothes, which makes them fun and easy to do because they're comfortable to wear and they're pretty easy to find. But a lot of times people don't know if you're in character or not because you're just wearing street clothes and people may or may not recognize that character. All of these costumes are mistaken for regular street clothes as often as they're recognized as costumes. So things to think about if you're doing a street clothes costume. First, get the details as accurate as you can. You know, even if you're just doing a guy in a suit, whatever sets that guy in a suit apart from those other guys in suits, make sure you get that detail. If you can't get them exactly accurate, just do the best you can. Get as many details as you can. And you know, nobody wants to go up and say, "Are you in costume? I can't tell," because that's embarrassing. It's embarrassing to them. It's embarrassing to you. So try to show that you're in costume. Make it clear that you're dressed as something other than a person. And if you have a costume that's similar to other costumes, pay really close attention to things like the cut of the clothes or the color scheme. For example, I've used these action figures because it makes it really obvious that they're not specific actors, but Malcolm Reynolds wears a solid color long sleeve button down shirt, pants, and suspenders, and he has a holster on his right side. Captain Jack Harkness wears a solid color button down shirt, suspenders, pants, and a holster on his right side. If you didn't have the colors to distinguish them, these costumes would look very similar. They're pretty much identical except for the boots at that point. So make sure that you get as many details as you can. Make sure you get, you know, if you're dressing up as Malcolm Reynolds, make sure you have boots that come up to your knees. Or if you're dressing as Captain Jack, you might want to get a vortex manipulator or wear the coat over the clothes. Just try to be as detail oriented as you can for costumes that are similar to other costumes so that you're recognizable. Also, keep in mind that if you go with a group, if you and several friends or your family can dress as something from the same source, it makes it a lot easier for people to recognize you in character or in that group of costumes. If you're playing a really obscure character from, you know, let's say you're dressing up as a character from the third book in a series or the fourth movie or the 10th episode of a TV show, and they're not a really well-known character, a lot of times people aren't going to recognize them. And that's not really unexpected. I love doing obscure characters that I really love and other people frequently don't know who I am. And I have to explain, oh, no, really, if you watch all the way to episode 37, this character shows up. But it's good if you can make it clear that you are in costume. And it's not always a reflection of your costuming skill. Sometimes the people who are around you just don't know that character, or don't know that source. It doesn't mean you didn't do a good job with it. Cosplay who you want to cosplay. Just be realistic about whether or not people are going to know who that is. And sometimes it helps to have a picture in your pocket of the character or on your phone. We live in a digital age. Don't print things on paper. But you know, if you pull out a picture and say, oh, this is who I'm dressed as, then people can go, oh, I get it now, I see. And you've educated them. And you may have made a new fan. And Sewing is Half the Battle, which is my cosplay team, is made up of three people. It's myself, my sister Laura, and our friend Mark, who is pictured here in costume. We were wearing these costumes at Gen Con. And this is a character who is from a popular TV series, but he's not well known. He was only in the second season. And people kept guessing who Mark was dressed as. They'd come up and say, are you dressed as someone from Les Mis? Are you a Star Trek character? My favorite one was, are you that kid from Treasure Planet? None of these were accurate. He's actually dressed as Captain John Hart from Torchwood. But it was in a more obscure costume and people didn't recognize it, but it became a lot more recognizable when I was running around with him because they would recognize Captain Jack because he's a Doctor Who character and a Torchwood character, and he's a lot more commonly known, and they would get the connection at that point. Even if they didn't know Mark's character, they knew he belonged with my character, and they stopped guessing things like Les Mis or Star Trek at that point. So being in groups can help. So once you've picked your costume, now you want to think about how to put that costume together from found objects or from a combination of found objects and pieces that you make. So you want to think about what pieces make up that costume. What parts are you going to need? What are the general shapes and silhouettes and colors? How does it fit? Is it really tight? Is it really loose? Is it very long? Is it very short? Just think about your basics at this point, like building blocks. So I'm going to go through a little case study here. River Song from Doctor Who, in this particular episode that I was dressing as, is wearing a denim jacket, a white shirt, and jeans, boots, and she has a holster as well. So these are all the components I analyzed. Okay, she's got this kind of flashlight. She's got this pouch. She's got this kind of revolver with a drop holster with Western tooling on it. And that, you know, things that I had to actually go through the DVD and say, what earrings is she wearing? Because they're kind of hard to see. They're little diamond studs. Okay. Once I had all of those pieces written down, then I could start breaking down what do I still need to find. So I went through my closet and identified what I already owned. In this case, I already had the jeans. I already had the Western boots. I already had a plastic revolver that I could press into service with some repainting. All the other things I would still need to find. Now, some of these are really easy to find. Diamond stud earrings or something that looks like diamond stud earrings, you can find those almost anywhere. Any accessories shop or department store or thrift store probably has something I could use for that. A small silver flashlight, not very difficult. You can buy flashlights a lot of places. A Western tooled leather holster, that's going to be a little harder to find at my local thrift store. So now I start looking online, looking on Amazon.com, looking at garage sales, looking at thrift stores. And I managed to find most of the pieces I needed secondhand, the shirt, the jacket, a purse that I could turn into the pouch. All of those things needed some modification, but I found them. I was able to find a wig at a local beauty supply store and the earrings, which cost me about $2. They were cheap. They're made out of plastic. I did have to order a new leather drop holster because holsters are not something you find really frequently at most garage sales or thrift stores. And then I went to a big box store and bought a flashlight. Next, the once you have assembled your pieces, now you need to make any aesthetic changes, which I'll talk a little more about aesthetics in a minute. So this is things like, do you need to tailor the clothing? Do you need to paint things? Do you need to dye fabric a different color? Do you need to style the wig? What elements do you need to change? So in my case, I found the jacket that kind of fit. It needed some tailoring. It also needed the color change because it was brown when I bought it. So I stripped out the brown dye and re-dyed it blue. That took some experimentation. Eventually I got it. Then I dyed the jeans to match the jacket. I hemmed the shirt and changed the fit on it. I cut the strap off the purse and put a belt loop on the back. I added a belt clip to the flashlight. Simple things, little modifications on those pieces. The fabric dyeing took more time than anything else. In the end, I had a fairly recognizable, fairly accurate costume that had all of the components I needed and didn't cost me that much money because except for the leather holster, everything was fairly cheap. You know, thrift stores, I'm paying $3 or $4 for items. It's not like buying a bunch of stuff new. And I was able to use things I already had, like the boots and the jeans. So that's an example of breaking down what pieces do I need, finding the pieces, modifying the pieces, and then put them together for the costume. Now, I said I would mention aesthetics. Excuse me a second. I'm talking a lot. Need a drink. So when you want to change the appearance of a found object to make it match your source more accurately, you have a lot of options for doing this. And this is all optional. You don't have to change everything. If you find a shirt that is 2 inches too long at the hem at a thrift store, but it's otherwise perfect, nobody cares if you go back and hem it the 2 inches. You may care if you want to put the work in and make your costume that much better. Awesome. Do it. Don't feel bad if you don't want to put that effort in though. Like this is all up to you how much time and effort you want to put into your costume. Some of the things I'm going to talk about may require some new skills. So you might want to watch some tutorials or look things up on how to use different materials. And cosplay is a great way to learn new skills. I had no formal training in sewing or crafting or any of this stuff. And now I do all kinds of professional work because I taught myself all this stuff specifically so I could dress up as characters and nerd out at geek conventions on weekends. Being a nerd is fun. So if you have a fabric item, shirt, pants, jacket, whatever, that is not exactly the right color, it is possible to dye or to lighten a lot of fabrics. This is easiest with natural fibers like cotton or linen or wool or silk. It's possible to do it with synthetics, but it's harder. So most of the dyes that you find at stores, like RIT dye, for example, are cotton dyes. They're meant to be used with natural fibers only. You can buy polyester dyes and nylon dyes, but they are specialty dyes and they are a little harder to mix your colors accurately, and they don't always dye completely as true as the cotton dye. So it's possible to do this, but if you don't have a lot of experience dyeing, try to stick to natural fibers at first while you're learning. If you need to strip dye out of a fabric, there is such a thing as dye remover. It's sold with fabric dyes. Rip makes one, Jacquard makes one. There are a lot of different companies. They don't work on every single shade. If you have a really strong shade like blue, the chemicals that are used in blue dye don't remove out completely, but it can lighten it. It can make it less blue. And then you could re-dye it another color. A lot of times people think, oh, I want to make this white, and they reach for the bleach. But bleach will actually partially dissolve your fabric. So unless you want your fabric to have a very rough, distressed look, try to avoid bleaching unless you have no other alternative. Use a dye remover first. Use a discharge paste first. But try to avoid bleaching unless you want it to look really beat up. And one thing I highly recommend is making test swatches before you actually dye your garment. So if you are like, I'm not sure about these two shades of blue, I'll pick one and see how it looks. Dye a small piece of fabric first to see what that color turns out to be before you start with a big piece. So here's some examples of test swatches. I was going for a very specific shade of blue. I ended up going through about 7 different dye manufacturers before I found the correct shade of blue. And it was a really good thing that I tested first, because the first several that I tried did not look anything like the color I wanted my fabric to be turned. And it would have ruined a lot of expensive fabric if I had just chucked it in there and gone with the dye straight off. There are a couple of different ways to dye fabrics. You can dye in a washing machine, or you can dye on the stovetop, which really only works with small pieces like under a yard, because your pot that you're putting on the stove is usually not big enough to accommodate a larger piece. But you have a lot more control over the dye process if you do stovetop dyeing. So if you're doing a very small piece, it's a really good way to control what color it turns and how saturated it is. However, don't use your actual cooking pots and pans for this, because you should not eat dye residue. So go to the thrift store, buy a cheap pot, buy a canning pot or something for as cheap as you can get it. Don't spend a lot of money on a nice pot, because you're just going to throw chemicals in it. And then you can do stovetop dyeing. I think I bought my canning pot for $6 some years ago at Dollar General or someplace. Don't spend a lot of money on equipment for this. So I mentioned already, my River Song jacket started brown and then I ended up dyeing it blue. The shorts I'm wearing as Lara Croft also started as a dark brown and I wanted them to be tan. So I used a dye remover and lightened them up to tan. If you're painting, and painting is a really good way to change the color of things that are not subject to dyeing, make sure you're using the right kind of paint for your material. For example, painting shoes, you almost always need to get a specific leather paint. And the best kind of leather paint, the one I use, is Angelus leather paint. You can order it online really easily. Amazon sells it. Lots of places sell it. But if you use something like spray paint or acrylic paint on most shoes, it'll start cracking and flaking as you wear the shoes. Leather paint doesn't do that. If you're painting fabric, you want to use a fabric paint or use a fabric painting medium, which is something you mix in with another kind of paint like acrylic paint to make it more flexible so it doesn't flake and crack on the fabric. Try to be as neat as possible when you're painting, and you can mask off your, if you need to make straight lines, you can use masking tape and mask your edges, just like if you were painting trim around a doorway. Put down the masking tape, paint lightly, and then pull the masking tape off while it's still wet so it dries with a nice straight edge. You can also make stencils for your fabric. One really common way to do that is to use freezer paper. Trace out the design you want. You can print it off from your computer, put the freezer paper over it, trace it, and then cut it out. And then you can iron the freezer paper, which has a wax backing, directly onto your fabric, paint, and then peel the fabric, the freezer paper off. And you've just made a stencil that you can paint through, and you have really nice, neat edges. That's something that is really good if you have to do repeated designs where you have several of the same thing happening all over the shirt rather than trying to freehand all of them. So here's an example. On the left, I found a pair of black shoes and I needed them to match my blue suit. So I painted them with blue leather paint. On the right, this is Mark painting his hat for Doctor Who. He was dressed as the 11th Doctor to go with my River Song, but he couldn't find a tan Western hat in time. So he bought a white Western hat and painted it with tan acrylic paint, and no one has ever known the difference. Something else you can do is appliqueing. Applique is where you take a fabric piece, you cut out a shape or a design, put it down on another fabric piece, and then sew around the edges. And applique is really good for doing a like a logo on a shirt. Or if you think back a few years ago to when Homestuck was a thing, doing the Homestuck emblems, the zodiac signs on the shirt, that a lot of people did that with applique. And you can also layer material over another material. Like you have a pair of shoes and you need parts of them to be alligator or snake skin. You can put a piece of vinyl over the shoes. So you have a lot of options for applique as well. Here's some fabric applique. On the left, the character Secret Go Racer has this triangle with a question mark. I just did that by I used some heat and bond adhesive, ironed the triangle onto the shirt, and then stitched around the edge. The M on Trixie's shirt is appliqued as well, and then has some glitter over it. And to make these gold alligator boots for an upcoming costume that I'm doing, I went to a thrift store, found a pair of plain black leather boots in my size, cut all the buckles off, and then glued some alligator texture vinyl over them and then painted them gold. So they're the same boots. I just completely changed what they looked like and reshaped the uppers just by cutting them apart and gluing stuff to them. Glue is great. Another thing you can do is to weather or distress your fabric. And this is really good if you have a character who would be out in the elements or a military character, like the Mandalorians from Mandalorian cosplay has gone back for years in the Star Wars fandom. And they all have their very distinct armor, but they always put, you know, little chips or chinks out of it or scratches. And you can do that by painting and then sanding or distressing. You can also do it by painting with, if you have a piece that's supposed to be metal, you can paint with fine silver lines and make it look like metallic scratches in the paint. I mentioned my Nathan Drake costume. I did a lot of dirtying and distressing on that costume because it's supposed to look very dirty and beat up. So I did everything from grinding coffee into it to spray painting it to dumping fabric dye on it, all sorts of things. So here's a couple of examples. On the left is that is a yellow a shirt that I had dyed yellow, and then I did a ton of brown spattering and dip dyeing in brown dye to make it look very dirty at the cuffs. And then on the right, a really cheap, hideous pair of Viking helmet horns that I then did some dry brushing on to make it look like old ivory for a costume, because I just cannibalized the horns off the helmet, so I didn't have to have anything heavy on because they were going on my head. Oh, and if you note the link at the bottom there, I do have a weathering and distressing tutorial on our website, which is andsewingishalfthebattle.com. We have a lot of tutorials, but I do have one specifically on weathering and distressing your costumes. And another thing you can do, and this works for modifying found objects and making things from scratch as well, you can combine any of those techniques to make new things. So when I was putting together my Captain Jack Harkness costume, as you see in the picture on the left, he is wearing an authentic 1940s RAF officer's cap. And I went to a local military antique shop and found an authentic World War II RAF officer's cap in my size even, and it was $350. And I said, I'm not sure I want to pay $350 for one piece of my costume. That's a lot of money to put into a hat. But what I found shortly thereafter was a $5 clearance bin that had like an old blue band cap in it. And I paid $5 for a hat. And then I took some scrap fabric, colored it with an alcohol-based marker until it was the exact right color to match that fabric. I sewed it over the plastic brim. I then dyed some cotton webbing, sewed it on, and put on an RAF insignia that I bought on eBay without the hat. And so my hat cost me actually about $25, and I didn't have to pay $350 for it. And people all the time think it's an authentic one because it looks like the officer's cap. I just took some good photos of the officer's cap, so I had a good reference to work from, and then I was able to match it very accurately by putting together several other techniques. So don't feel like you have to buy a finished product if you can buy something that is cheaper and just do it yourself. Also, I didn't necessarily want to be throwing an actual antique hat into my suitcase every time I went to a convention, getting it crushed. I'm a historic preservationist as well. I'm on the board of a historical society, so I don't like damaging antiques unless I have no other option. All right, so we're going to go through relatively quickly just some case studies to give you an idea of what is possible with found objects as soon as I get another drink. Okay, This is a costume that a friend of ours put together very, very quickly. It's Shaoran from Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicle, and she already owned the khakis. I think I lent her the black shirt, and then the tan cloak that's all shredded at the edge is a bed sheet that we bought on the way to the convention, went into the bathroom, safety pinned it around her neck, and then took a pair of scissors to the edges to make it all shredded. Very high tech, shredding a bed sheet in the bathroom with scissors. It was a very cheap costume. She was recognizable. Everybody knew who she was, and she had a good time doing it and didn't have to do a lot of cash outlay. This is my Clint Barton costume from the Avengers, the first film. And the advantage of doing costumes based on movies and television shows is that the actors actually have to wear clothes in real life. And if you look closely or can figure out or can go to any of the websites that tell you what brands of clothing they use in the show, you can just buy the same brands. So I did some research, discovered that it was a discontinued Black Hawk tactical vest that he was wearing in that film. I found a clearance site, bought myself a discontinued Black Hawk tactical vest, sewed it down about four sizes because it was made for a large military man, and I am a petite female. But I was able to get the pockets and everything exactly right because I just bought the same thing they used in the movie. So if you can do that, it works well. This is a case where, that fast, cheap, good diagram, I left off the cheap one because this is actually an 1880s tailcoat that I bought at an antique store. I curate a collection of vintage clothing, and so I tend to acquire a lot of vintage clothing pieces. And I saw this in the shop and I thought, huh, I bet I can turn that into a historically accurate Sebastian costume. And so everything I wore in this was antique. And I still have it in my vintage clothing collection. And I use it in museum displays as well, but I wore it first. This was a very lucky thrift store find. Both the coat and the hat for this costume came from Goodwill. And the mask I bought on Halloween clearance from Target and then spray painted. So I have maybe, it's definitely less than $20 in this entire costume. And pretty accurate for the character. Simple, bright primary color costumes. I love the classic 60s Speed Racer cartoon, and so I made my friends dress up as certain characters with me. That's me and Racer X there. And most of this is very easy found object modification. We got Mark a blue polo shirt. I painted the collar white, very high tech. We appliqued the G on. The helmet there is, I pulled that motorcycle helmet out of the trash at an estate auction. It had been discarded because it was broken. I spray painted it white and used red electrical tape to cut out the M. Again, very high tech. I've mentioned Uncharted several times. Really simple costume. I had already made the holster for another costume. It was my Risa Hawkeye holster, and I was able to recycle it and repurpose it for this costume. So then I just had to dirty up a t-shirt and put on some jeans that I already owned. Jack Frost from Rise of the Guardians, based on real clothes, obviously, but has a very specific look to it. So this was one where I did a lot of fabric dyeing to get the colors right, did a lot of tailoring as well to get that sort of distinctive shape to the hoodie that he's wearing. And then I took a tree branch out of my backyard that had blown down in a storm, cut it into pieces, screwed the pieces back together in the right shape, and made myself a staff. Everybody else was trying to make staffs out of things like PVC, and I'm like, I have a tree. I'll just use a tree. Pinstripe suit, pretty easy. The only thing that was difficult on this one was I had to hide my eyebrows and put on fake eyebrows, which again, makeup is not that difficult. Kate Bishop, it's a t-shirt. Pretty easy. Miss Quill from class. This is another one where a lot of people don't realize I'm actually in costume when I wear this one. That's because she wears street clothes. Pretty easy to put together. Agent Carter, I did this one initially for one of the movie re-releases. I think it was the when Age of Ultron, or no, one of the later Avengers films came out, and a local theater had a screening, an encore screening of Captain America. And so I dressed as Peggy Carter to go to the theater. And then I just kept wearing it because it's a really comfortable costume. These costumes are put together out of found items with modifications. So there was a lot of sewing, like sewing the flames onto the sleeve of the tuxedo, sewing the iridescent ribbons onto it was a white prom dress that I had in my closet. Painting the jacket. All of those are simple modifications, of pieces of clothing that we didn't have to make. So at the time, this was one of the first costume sets we ever did. None of us knew how to sew really yet. We were still learning everything, but I could handle painting and I could handle pinning things. It was just, I didn't really know how to sew them together. So using clothes that already existed helped us make costumes that looked really good. And we just did all the surface detail to them. This costume is primarily things from Goodwill. And then I made the cape out of a square of fabric. And I commissioned the hat from a friend who made hats professionally because I tried to make the hat and failed. And then the dove is from a craft store. This is stuff I bought on eBay, mostly eBay and thrift stores. So Vietnam uniform that I, it was actually, the sleeves were already cut off because the tropical combat uniforms frequently have the sleeves cut off for that reason. And then I painted a shirt that I got at a thrift store for the tank top. This is dollar yard clearance bin fabric over a dress I already owned. Oh, and I used a rock and some twist ties and some gold paint to make the necklace. Very high tech. I did actually knit the scarf on this one, but everything else is found object from a thrift store, including the doctor's jacket. I just found it at Salvation Army. One other thing you can do is cannibalize things. So if you need to make something that has a specific fabric pattern or a specific texture to it, and you can't find clothes with that texture, you can always go to a thrift store and go through their linen section and say, oh, these former curtains have that texture. How can I use them? Or this bed sheet has that color. And this is something that actually a lot of professionals do this too. So the 10th Doctor from Doctor Who has this distinctive blue pinstriped, it's brown with light blue pinstripes, this suit that's very difficult to find. The fabric was discontinued actually before the series ran. So cosplayers have always had a really hard time finding the right kind of suit fabric. Well, that's because the suit fabric that they used for the show was actually trouser fabric. This was a pair of Gap trousers that they found that were already discontinued when they made the show. And the BBC costume department went around the UK and bought up every remaining pair of these pants, cut them apart, and used the fabric to make the jackets for David Tennant to wear. So they just cannibalized the fabric from another piece of clothing. You can do the same thing. If your character has a specific type of cape or skirt or you know, anything that you can't find the fabric for, look at other random things. Look at chair upholstery fabric. Look at tablecloths. I've got a tablecloth that I bought in 2002, and I've used pieces of that tablecloth in probably 10 different costumes because it's a specific texture that you can't find anywhere else. So absolutely recycle things. They don't have to be used for their original purpose. An acquaintance of mine was doing a costume on commission for someone, and she was making this character, and she couldn't find the fabric with the embroidered symbols on it, the kanji. And then she was in a home goods store and saw these pillows. So she bought a bunch of the pillows, cut up the pillows, and used them to make the fabric for the rest of the costume. So cannibalize. Mark's Chauvelin hat, this tricorn hat with the tricolor on it, we made out of a floppy sun hat that I paid 99 cents for at Goodwill. Props, you can do this with props. I mentioned my Loki staff previously was a Coke bottle with a sheet protector and an LED glow stick stuck inside, stuck to a broom handle with some foam taped over it. When I made my grenades for the Uncharted photos that I did, they are a Little Tykes ball and a plastic butter knife. I got the Little Tykes ball from a ball pit. It was at the thrift store. I think I paid 39 cents for it. And then I just painted the whole assembly with acrylic paint and stuck a keychain on the side. I am cheap. All right. So if you want to make a specific character's costume, obviously the first thing is to look at their basic costume that you see most often and say, can you find or make that costume? If not, does the character have other costume designs that you can use as a basis for a costume? This is true really commonly with comic book characters or characters who have been done in reboots. They'll have slight variations on the costume. So for example, Catwoman in the 1940s looked very different than Catwoman now. And I know we don't talk about the Halle Berry movie because it was terrible, but you know, if you look at all the different costume elements, if you want to do a Catwoman costume, you have about 15 costumes to choose from at this point. You can also look at what was the original costume versus what was the TV adaptation versus what was the theatrical film versus what was the stage play, you know, all the different elements. So the Green Hornet, for example, started as a radio character, radio serials, and then they did a film serial, and then they ended up doing a TV show and comic books. And we don't talk about the Seth Rogen movie either because it was also bad. But there have been many, many different variations. So you could pick out a different version. If you don't have the resources to do the specific costume that you were thinking of, but you can do another version of the character, that's an option. I once made a Green Hornet costume for Mark out of a thrift store suit that I happened to find that was green and just threw a bunch of other stuff together. And it wasn't exactly based on the TV series, but it was still recognizable as the character because it was similar to some of the other costumes. And we wore it to a Halloween party and people actually recognized it. It was great. Another thing you can do is look at memorable episodes with that character. So things like, does the character have a battle damage moment? Does the character dress up in disguise at any point? Does the character just have a bunch of different costumes? So the 11th Doctor from Doctor Who, the most common costume that you see people doing is the one on the upper left here, the tweed jacket with the bow tie. But he does have a lot of other costumes that he goes through during his tenure on the show. And you could do any one of those. Princess Leia has a lot of costumes. You don't have to do, you know, cinnamon bun Leia. You don't have to do slave Leia from Jabba's palace. You have a lot of other options that are all valid costumes for that character. So even if you just say, I know the costume's really hard, but I want to do this character, you may not even have to do that costume to still do this character. Another thing, especially for anime and manga, there's always concept art and promotional art. Video games have concept art and promotional art. This is a character I cosplay quite frequently. I've done about 7 different costumes because he has a bunch of them. This is his base costume. It's complicated. If this is beyond your sewing skill, because I've done that applique and it's not easy, then you could say, oh, well, I will do one of the other many simpler costumes, like the cable knit sweater. That's going to be a lot easier to find than a big swirling applique cloak. It is also perfectly acceptable to do a similar or based on or inspired by costume. So if you have a character that you love, but you don't think you can do the character's costume exactly as it appears, can you do a version of it? Can you do an inspired by? I'm going to do something that's from the same general period in history or the same color scheme, or I'm going to do a ball gown version of it or a gender bend version of it, or, you know, just something similar, something inspired by. And that's okay. That's perfectly acceptable. You can do that. I've done this with characters that I was doing for games. We do Gen Con every year. And in this case, I was doing a LARP, a live action role play, where I, even though I was cosplaying this character in the actual 6-foot wide ball gown that she wears in the stage play, I didn't want to take my really complicated, hard to move in silk ball gown into a live action role play scenario. So I went to Goodwill and spent $15 on random other stuff and cut it up and put it together in a day. And I have a costume that I could then, it was basically disposable at that point because I had just put it together from a bunch of prom dresses and things that I didn't care about. And it was fine. Another thing you can do is go with groups with a friend and do something relating to that, even if it's not a specific character. Ensemble casts are great for this. So this is the cast of Firefly. There are a lot of different characters in that show. You could go as any one of them, or you could go as a character in the same aesthetic as, you know, can you do a similar costume, even if it's not a specific character? Yeah, you can. Most people look at this and say, oh, Star Wars cosplayers. Okay, yeah, the Stormtrooper is kind of a giveaway. There's also some Jedi. There's somebody with a lightsaber. I don't know what this is. This is somebody in a PVC cat suit and a random belt. This is actually my sister who didn't have a Star Wars costume, and we were going to a Star Wars event, and she just threw on some random stuff out of her closet, and that was her costume. And people took her photo, and they just assumed she was one of the characters from the Expanded Universe because who knows? So you can still go in costume and have a good time. You don't have to dress as a specific character. This is my brother-in-law who is wearing an ugly sweater, eating lollipop, and holding a PlayStation remote. It's not exactly a giveaway until you realize that he's picking on Harry Potter, and he went as Dudley Dursley, who's not actually pictured in any of the book cover art or anything. This was before the movies. So he was able to be a character who was a minor character and still participate in the, this was a bookstore release party. So things to remember, things to take home. If you can find pieces in a completed form, go ahead and use them. If they're perfect, great. You don't have to modify them. If you need to modify them, you have a lot of options for how to modify them. Look for the most salient things like color and size and shape first. That applies to both clothing and props. And your details are important. So match your details as much as you can in terms of, you know, if you have a costume that's based on street clothes or based on things that might not be immediately recognizable as a costume set apart from what you would wear on a daily basis, make sure you can be as specific as possible with character elements that'll help you sell that character. And as much as possible, when you're posing for photos or when you're hanging out in groups, convey your character in the way that you stand, in the way that you pose for a photo. I do a whole 2-hour seminar on posing for cosplay photos. I could talk for a very long time about that. But if you are in costume and somebody says, oh, can I take your picture? You don't have to just stand there very stiff and, okay, I'm waiting. I'm doing the school photo pose. You don't have to do that. You can crouch down into an action pose. You can do something with your prop. You can threaten another character if you're a bad guy. You know, do something that's more in character, which makes for a much more fun and recognizable photo. And when all else fails, you can think outside the costume. So this was an acquaintance of mine who, when one of the, it might have been The Dark Knight, one of the Nolan Batman films was having its premiere, and he and a bunch of friends all had the same Batman shirt, and they were all going to wear their Batman shirts and go see the film as soon as they got off work. Well, he got to his work, which is an hour away from his home, and realized he had left his Batman shirt at home. So he stopped by a Walgreens, bought 2 sheets of poster board, tied them together over his shoulders with strips of plastic bag from the Walgreens, and wrote POW on it and cut around the edge. And he went as the 1960s Batman, you know, bam, biff, POW, as all of the onomatopoeia from the fight scenes in the 60s Batman. And he had a way better response than if he'd just been wearing a Batman shirt, because everybody wears a Batman shirt, but he went to the Batman POW sign. So you can always do something creative, even if it's not a specific costume or not what you were planning on, and still have a good time dressing up as a character or an element that you like from that source. So we are going to have some question and answer time. Again, you can submit questions via Facebook comments or YouTube. I think the YouTube chat is running, and my helper will feed those questions to me, and I will answer them. I know there's about a 20-second delay, so I will try not to stare at the wall too hard while I'm counting for that. In the meantime, this is our social media and our website. Pretty much any site you go to, except for Twitter, we're just Enzo Wings Half the Battle. Twitch, everything. I don't have Twitch on here, but we are also Enzo Wings Half the Battle on Twitch. Twitter, back when we made the account, that was too many characters for a Twitter handle. So we are ASIHDB on Twitter. But feel free to check out any of our tutorials or follow us or send me your questions on social media as well. And I will stop sharing so that I can get back to the Zoom screen. Okay, there we go. So if we have any questions, I can talk about them now.
Okay, I'm waiting for anyone to pop up yet in our YouTube and our... Oh, okay. So I have a question.
Okay.
From Grace. How long did it take you to learn to sew?
How long did it take me to learn to sew? It depends on when you start counting, because if you count from my 7th grade home ec class that I almost failed and made me think that I was never going to be any good at sewing, it took a lot longer. So nobody in my immediate family sewed anything. My mother doesn't sew, you know, I didn't have any relatives who sewed immediately. So I didn't grow up with the concept of sewing as a thing that you could do. I had the one required semester of home ec in 7th grade. My teacher yelled at me a lot and I never learned anything from it. And I just thought I was bad at sewing. So the first several costumes I made, they were literally held together on the inside with duct tape and safety pins because I didn't know anything about sewing. Then I graduated to hot glue, which I discovered is not very durable. And after about 2 years of trying to put costumes together with literally anything other than a needle and thread, I broke down and said, okay, look, if I'm going to keep wearing costumes, I'm going to have to learn the basics of sewing. And I would say from the point when I started trying to figure out which end of the needle went into the fabric, to the point where I actually felt reasonably competent at sewing, you know, garments, was probably about 2 to 3 years, because I was coming from a background of nothing and I had to learn everything. The point at which I finally accepted, oh, I'm actually good at this, was more like 8 or 10 years, because there was always that little niggling voice of doubt that said, you don't know what you're doing, you're just faking it. And it, part of that goes back to the fact that my seventh grade home ec teacher insulted me and yelled at me a lot and told me I was never going to be good at it, which says something about early life experience. And part of it was, because I was self-taught, when we started, YouTube didn't exist. There was no such thing as a video tutorial on the internet. Yes, I'm old. So a lot of it was just trial and error. A lot of it was, I don't understand what the directions mean, so I'll just try to do it this way. And it wasn't until more resources were available and I could actually kind of check my work and say, oh, I did it correctly, that I realized I was able to do it. So I would say the simple answer is 2 to 3 years, to the point where I felt competent making like a pair of pants or a jacket from scratch. To the point at which I thought, okay, I can actually do this professionally and not feel like I'm totally taking somebody's money under false pretenses, was about 8 years. And a lot of hours, because some of our costumes were like 300-hour costumes.
Yeah, I hear you about the home ec thing. I did a pillow, and it did not turn out like the square it's supposed to have been. And they're like, well, good luck.
Yeah. My final project in my home ec class was a sweatshirt, and it was a kit. You know, it came with a pattern, came with the fabric. And I kept that sweatshirt for years. I actually wore it. It was a perfectly functional sweatshirt. I had one mistake, which was on the left cuff. And I still remember this many years later that on my grade sheet that came back with that project, my teacher had written unbelievable with a double underline and this horrible, like, wrote nasty comments about my sewing. I had made one mistake in the entire project with no sewing background and no help from her. And she wrote nasty, insulting comments. And that was the point where I'm like, hey, I'm never going to do this. I'm never going to be good at it. So it took me a really long time to actually try to learn to sew. And then lo and behold, once I actually had motivation to learn about something like putting clothes together because I wanted to do costumes, then I turned out to actually be halfway decent at it. But, you know, when you don't have somebody yelling at you all the time, you learn a lot faster.
Yeah. We have another question from Grace. What are some of your favorite costumes?
What are some of my favorite costumes? This is a really hard question because picking a favorite costume is kind of like picking a favorite child. There are characters I really love and there are costumes I really love, and they're not necessarily the same things. The costume that I show most often to people and the one that I'm probably proudest of from a technical standpoint is Marguerite from the Scarlet Pimpernel, which is the 6-foot-wide fluorescent pink silk ball gown. It's a robe à la française. It's got the grand panier with the steel boning underneath it, and it's got a 4-foot train off the back, and it's very elaborate. And I think... Hang on, what's the next panel I'm doing on Friday? That one is...
Patterns Lie.
Okay, no, I don't talk about Marguerite in that one. I was trying to think if I was actually going to be talking about how I made that at any point this week, but I don't think so. But it is, you know, it's because it's a historical piece, I did have some resources in how to put it together, but then it had to be modified because it was actually based on a stage costume. It was not based on specifically a historical version. So it's got some variations, but it is, it has a lot of, you know, hand set jewels, hand embroidery, hand painted lace, hand everything. And it was a big feat of engineering. And it was also a really intimidating project because it was huge and involved a lot of, I think I sourced fabric from 5 countries for that dress. So it was a big project for me. And I spent 3 years collecting the materials for it. So that's the one I'm probably, you know, proudest of from a technical standpoint. But I also, you know, I really love cosplaying Jack Harkness because it's a lot of fun, even though it's not a costume that I did near as much work on. It's still just fun to wear. And there's a character named Lucrezia Noin that was my first dream costume, you know, the costume that I never thought I'd be good enough to do. And it's a military uniform, and it's not actually that complicated now looking back on it. But when I first started cosplaying, I thought, oh my gosh, that's the costume. One day I hope I'm good enough to sew that costume. And we did. And I'm still really proud of it. And it makes me happy to wear it. And so, you know, there are several different costumes that I love for different reasons. But there's also the simple fact that I've been cosplaying long enough that we've made over 300 costumes at this point. So it would be really hard to pick one single favorite out of all of them, because I don't tend to cosplay characters that I don't have some affinity for. So I'm usually really motivated to make and wear a costume if I'm going to put the time and effort into making a costume. And so I kind of love them all. I do have a couple costumes that I absolutely hate, but that's mostly because everything went wrong with them and I can't stand to look at them anymore. But those were also costumes that I was not motivated to do for myself. I did them as trades with other people. So that makes them less dear to my heart.
Okay. We have another question from Grace. What's the easiest way to make yourself unrecognizable?
Change your eyebrows. So your brain has a section that is designed to recognize faces. If you change your eyebrow shape, the brain goes, what? This is a new person. I don't know who this is. So if you're just doing, you know, general changing your face makeup, take an Elmer's glue stick, layer glue stick over your eyebrow hair, put foundation over it, and then give yourself new eyebrows somewhere else. And when people look at you, they're going to do that double take thing, and it's great fun. So eyebrows are really, really key to that. Changing your mouth shape can also do that, or your jawline. The makeup that I've done a lot of weird makeup. I've done like aliens and non-human entities, and I've painted myself blue and green and glued rocks to my face and all kinds of stuff. The makeup that actually fooled my mother into not recognizing me at all, because she's seen me in a lot of costumes, was actually Nathan Drake, because I had stubble glued to my chin. I had different eyebrows. I'd done a more masculine jawline with makeup. And she actually walked up, and Laura and I were standing together talking. She walked up and said to Laura, where's your sister? I haven't seen her all morning. And Laura just pointed at me, and my mother looked at me and then looked around and, no, I don't see her. Where is she? So, stubble helps if you're female and you've never had a beard and then you suddenly have a beard. That confuses people too. But as far as being less likely to be recognized, any changes to your eyebrows are going to be the fastest and easiest way.
And we have one other question from Grace.
Thank you for all the questions, Grace.
Yeah. What is the weirdest item you have included in a costume or prop?
Oh, wow. What is the weirdest item you have ever included? All right. So commercial dairies, big milking operations that deal with hundreds of cattle, have these rubber sleeves that go on the cow's udder, the teat on the cow's udder as part of the pump to pump the milk when they're milking a cow. I got one somewhere. I think it was at a dog training conference. I'm a professional animal trainer as well. And I was at a conference and I think somebody gave them out because they also use them as dog toys. They're just like weird black rubber tubes with strange shapes at the end. And I later incorporated that piece of milking equipment into a crossbow that I was making for a video game character. So that's probably the weirdest one. But I also recycle a lot of junk. Like if I find random stuff under a shelf in my garage, I'll put it in a box somewhere and I'll find a way to use it.
I have a question myself. Okay. Have you ever used the Cricut? Do you know what the Cricut is from, like, it's like a craft. It cuts out paper.
Oh, yes. For like the cutting paper and vinyl.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you ever used that in any of your costumes?
Yes and no. I don't own one. I have a laser cutter, which is... Mm-hmm. Like a much, much larger and more powerful version. So I do use cutout things, but I don't use the mechanical kind. However, Two of my friends have them, and I have had them cut things out for me. We did last year for Gen Con, we did a huge group, like 12 or 14 people, recreated the Leonard Nimoy Ballad of Bilbo Baggins music video. So everybody's got these shirts with these weird, like a flower design on them in black. And so we cut all of those out on, I don't remember if it was a Cricut or a Silhouette. It was one of the two. They're very similar, they're competitors. We cut out those out of heat set vinyl and did those. I've done some, small designs for detailing cut out of those. So yeah, I have used pieces that were made on one, but I don't myself own one, because I thought having both a Cricut and a laser cutter was probably redundant. Although I actually can't cut vinyl on the laser cutter in the same way, because the vinyl can damage the laser. So I don't know, maybe there is an application for that.
Okay. Let me check to see if any other body has a question.
Okay.
And now we wait for the 20-second delay.
Yeah, that's the thing is, when we do Twitch streams, and on Twitch it varies between 20 and 22 seconds. And so, if you're watching the comment feed on a second screen, you have to keep in mind, okay, what did I say 20 seconds ago, and what is this comment, and how is it relevant to that, and is there a
Yeah.
question? And
Okay, I don't have any other questions coming through. I would like to mention if you're using the Beanstack for our activities and challenges for your grand prizes, the activity code for this session is costuming with a capital
Costuming.
C.
Costuming with
Costuming,
a capital C.
yep. Okay, I think that we're all good for questions.
Okay. And again, if you're tuning in later, if you're watching this on the replay, and you do have questions, you are welcome to hit us up on any of our social media. You can email us from our website. We also, you can message me on Tumblr, or I'm on Instagram, I'm on Twitch, I'm on lots of things. So feel free to contact us if you do have a question later. And thank you for tuning in.
Thank you. I'm gonna end there. Yeah, okay.